Welcome everyone to the class. We are going to continue with discussion of what kind of design choices do we have when training or designing graph neural networks. And then in the last part of the lecture today, we are going to talk about graph neural network training and various other aspects of how do we make these models work. So to start, to remind everyone, we are discussing deep graph encoders, in particular graph neural networks, where the idea is that given the input graph on the left, we want to transform it through several layers of nonlinear transformations, several layers of a neural network to come up with good predictions at the level of nodes, edges, as well as entire graphs. The formalism we have defined is called graph neural network, where basically for every node in the network, we define the computation graph that is based on the network neighborhood around that given target node. So essentially, this means that the input graph network structure around the target node defines the neural network structure. And then we discussed that now, in order to make this neural network architecture work, because every node gets to define its own neural network architecture, its own computational graph that will depend on the position of the node in the network, then what we can do in the to make this work is we have to define several different operators in the architecture. So first we said we need to define what we call a message passing function, a message transformation function that will take the message from the child, transform it and pass it towards the parent. We have to define the notion of message aggregation that will take the transformed messages from the children and aggregate them in an order invariant way to produce the one combined message from the children. Then we said that when this message arrives to the parent, we need to decide how to combine it with the parent's own message from the previous level to then create the embedding of the node, which can then be passed on. So this is how we defined a single layer of a graph neural network. Then we discussed how to combine or how do you link a stack multiple layers together. And what we are going to discuss today is the point number four around what kind of graph and feature augmentation can we create to shape the structure of this neural network, as well as we are going to talk about learning objectives and how to make the training work. So that's the plan for today. So first, let's talk about graph augmentation for graph neural networks. So the idea is that raw input graph does not necessarily need to present the underlying computation graph. Right, so what I discussed so far was that if I want to create a graph neural network for a given target node in the network, then I take the information from the neighbors of it, here are the neighbors, and then each of the neighbors takes information from its own neighbors, and this defines the graph neural network. However, this translation from the input graph structure to the graph neural network structure does not need to be kind of one-to-one. I don't need to take the raw input graph and interpret it as the computational graph. I can use various kinds of techniques to create the computation graph of the graph neural network. And the two techniques we are going to talk about is graph feature augmentation and graph structure augmentation. So what we assume so far, as I said, is that the raw input graph directly defines the computational graph of the graph neural network. And there are many good reasons why we would want to break this assumption. So we would want to break it at the level of node features. Many times, for example, input graphs may lack features, attributes. Perhaps we want to sometimes features are also hard to encode. So we may want to help the neural network to learn a given concept easier. And then in terms of graph structure, sometimes graphs, input graphs tend to be too sparse. And it's inefficient to do message passing over a very sparse graph. It would take a lot of iterations, a lot of GNN depth. Sometimes they are too dense and the message passing becomes too costly. If you think, for example, doing message passing on top of an Instagram or Twitter network and you hit, you know, the Kim Kardashian node, then you need to aggregate from all her gazillions of followers, right? So that is very expensive. So the question is, when you hit a high degree node, what do you do? Do you really need to aggregate from all the neighbors of that high degree node, or perhaps can you just select a subset of the neighbors? And then another important consideration is that sometimes this graph is just too large, so we cannot fit the computation graph into the GPU memory, and again, certain augmentation techniques are needed. So basically the point is that sometimes it is unlikely that the input graph happens to be the optimal computation graph for computing GNN-based embeddings. And the techniques we are going to discuss next will give you some ideas what can we do to improve the structure of the graph so that it lends better to the graph neural network embeddings. So we are going to talk about augmentation approaches, and we are going to talk about, in particular, the graph feature augmentation, where it can be the case that the input graph lacks attributes, lacks features, and we are going to create features so that GNN has easier time to learn. And then we'll also talk about the graph structure augmentation. As I said, if graph is too sparse, we will be able to add virtual nodes and edges. If it's too dense, we can decide to do some kind of sampling of neighbors when doing message passing. And if graph is too large, then we can subsample subgraphs to compute the embeddings. And this last point, we are going to talk in more detail when we discuss scaling up GNNs. But these are some of the techniques we are going to learn about today. So why do we need feature augmentation, right? So first, I want to talk about graph feature augmentation. So let's discuss why do we need this. Sometimes input graphs do not have any node features. This is common, right, if the input is just the graph adjacency matrix. And what I'm going to discuss next is several standard approaches. How do you deal with this situation and what can you do? So first idea is that you simply assign a constant value, a constant feature to every node. So basically all the nodes have the same feature value, value of one. And then if you think of what aggregation does, it basically counts how many neighbors, does a node have at level one, how many do they have at level two, how many do they have at level three. So this would in some sense allow you still to capture some notion of how does the network neighborhood structure about a given node look like, even though all the nodes have the same feature, which has value one. Another idea that you can do is to assign unique IDs to nodes. So basically these IDs are then converted to one hot vectors, right? So basically it means if you have a network on six nodes, then the idea is that you can assign a one hot encoding to every node in the network. So what I mean by this is now a feature vector for every node in the network is simply a six-dimensional binary vector where, you know, node ID number five has a value of one up here, if this is, you know, the node ID number five. Also notice that this ordering of the nodes is totally arbitrary. So there are some issues with one-hot encodings because it might be hard or impossible to generalize them across different graphs. But if you work with a single graph, then this type of approach might be fine because every node basically has now a unique one-hot encoding. There is a flag value one at the ID of that single node. And this now allows you to learn very expressive models because the models know actually what are the IDs of the neighbors of the node in the network. Of course, it might be costly because now your feature representation, your number of attributes that the node has, number of features the node has, equals the number of nodes in the network. So that is quite an expensive feature representation for a node if the network is large. So how do these two approaches compare, right? How does this adding a constant feature versus one hot encoding, how do they compare, right? In terms of the expressive power, constant feature, so every node having a value of one, has kind of medium expressive power, right? All nodes are identical, but as we will talk about this later, GNN can still learn about the graph structure and the neighborhood structure around the node, right? In some sense, let's say an aggregation function like summation allows you to say, aha, I have three, if this is the node of interest, I have three neighbors at level one, I have, let's say, two neighbors at level two, and so on and so forth, right? So this is what this will be able to learn. So it's still able to capture some simple part of the graph structure. One hot encoding has high expressive power, right? Each node has a unique ID, so a node-specific information can be stored or can be retrieved or learned. So you can learn, oh, I have a neighbor with ID number two, and perhaps that is important to determine your own label. So the expressive power is very high. You know, does this approach allow for an inductive learning capability? What does this mean is generalization to unseen nodes or generalization to nodes that are not yet part of the network or generalization to a new graph that I have never seen during training. Of course, the constant feature has high inductive learning capability because it's simple to generalize to new nodes, to new graphs. We assign constant feature to them and just apply a GNN. While, for example, in the one hot encoding case, we cannot really do that, right? Because we cannot generalize to new nodes, right? New nodes introduce new IDs. Those IDs were not part of the training. The GNN does not know how to embed unseen nodes. So this is the issue in terms of one hot encodings. You need to know the entire node set at the time of training, and you need to know the edges of that node set at the time of training. In terms of computational cost, as I said, constant node feature is very cheap. It's just one value per node, while the one hot encoding has high because each node has a feature vector that is length of the size of the network, right? It's number of vertices is the dimensionality of the feature vector. So we cannot apply this to large graphs. And then, you know, when would you apply one or the other? You can apply the constant feature essentially to any graph whenever you care about inductive setting and generalizing to new nodes, but the expressive power of the model will be limited. On the other hand, one hot encoding is very powerful, allows you to learn much more intricate structure around the network, but it can only be applied to small graphs and to transductive settings, basically where all the nodes and all the edges are known at the time of the training of the model. So this was in terms of one idea of feature augmentation when we have no features on the nodes. Another motivation for why we would want to do some feature augmentation is that sometimes certain structures are hard to learn for a GNN. So sometimes we actually want to encode a bit of a graph structure into the node attribute vector as well. So the idea, for example, is that to give you an example, like kind of an edge example, is that it's a very hard for a GNN to count, you know, what's the length of a cycle a node is on. So, and the question is, you know, could a GNN learn the length of a cycle a given node resides in? And unless you have discriminative node features, this is not possible, right? So what I mean by this is, for example, here in this example, node V1 resides on a cycle of length 3, while here the node V1 resides on a cycle of length 4. And in both cases, right, V1 has degree 2 and its neighbors have degree 2. So it's kind of the question is, you know, how does this node know that now it's in a cycle of length 4 versus 3? Something like this is very important, for example, in chemistry, because this could be different kinds of chemical structures or different kinds of ring structures. And the reason why a plain GNN cannot differentiate between, you know, node 1 in cycle of length 3 versus cycle of length 4 is that if you look at the GNN computation graph, for both these nodes, V1 and V2, the computation graph is exactly the same, meaning V1 and V2 have two neighbors each, and then, you know, these neighbors have one neighbor each, and the computation graph will always look like this. Unless, right, you have some way to discriminate nodes based on the features. But if the nodes have the same set of features, they are not, you cannot discriminate them based on their attributes, then you cannot learn to discriminate node V1 from V2. They will, from the GNN point of view, they will all look the same. I'm going to go to more depth around this this example and what are some very important implications of it and consequences of it when we are going to discuss the theory of graph neural networks. But for now, the important thing is to see, to understand that a GNN has hard time capturing or is not able to capture whether a node is on a length 3 cycle or a length 4 cycle unless these nodes on the cycle would have some discriminative features. And the reason why we are not able to distinguish between these two nodes, or why GNN is not able to distinguish between these nodes, is because computation graph looks the same in both cases, right? A node has two neighbors, and then each of these neighbors has two other neighbors. And if all the neighbors look the same, they don't have any discriminative colors to them, then computation graphs in all cases will look the same. So the embeddings will be the same. So it doesn't matter whether you are part of a cycle or you are part of an infinite length chain, the computation graph will always be the same. So the GNN won't be able to distinguish the nodes, again, unless there is some discrimination between the nodes. So if nodes have different colors, then a GNN could capture the pattern. So what is the solution? The solution is to create a feature vector for every node that would, for example, give me the cycle count, right? So basically, I would augment the node features with the cycle count information. So one idea, for example, would be is to create this vector where, you know, this is the number of cycles of length 0 the node participates in, number of cycles of length 1, length 2, length 3, right? So length 1 is a self loop. Length 2 would be, if in a directed graph, would be a reciprocated connection. Length 3 is a triangle. You know, length 4 is a square. Right, and you could now append this type of feature vector to whatever feature vector you already have for the nodes, and this way increase the expressive power of the graph neural network, especially if your intuition is that, let's say, cycle information is important. And of course, there are many other commonly used techniques to augment features. People very much like to include node degree. It's a very simple to compute feature, but again, allows you to distinguish between different nodes. You can include clustering coefficient that essentially counts how many cycles of length 3 a node participates in. So this is triangle counting. You could also add other types of features like page rank or node centrality metrics, right? So essentially, any features we have introduced in lecture 2 you could include to augment the GNN to help it learn the network structure better and faster, right? So in some sense, in many cases, the goal of the machine learning scientist is to essentially understand the intuition behind the learning algorithm and tries to help the algorithm to learn the patterns perhaps we as domain scientists would know are important. And by encoding some of the graph features, many times you can very much speed up and improve the performance of the model because you kind of help, you know, you point the model to the places where there might be good signal. So this was about augmenting the features of the node. And we talked about adding a constant feature. We talked about adding one hot encoding. And we also talked about adding various kinds of graph structure information like the cycle count or node degree to augment the node feature information. Now I'm going to switch gears and I'm going to talk about adding and changing the graph structure information. So we are going to augment the underlying graph structure again to help with the learning. The way we are going to do this is to add virtual nodes and virtual edges. So the first motivation we want to discuss is we want to augment sparse graphs. So we want to add virtual edges. A common approach, for example, would be to connect two hop neighbors via virtual edges. So the intuition is, or one way to say this, is that instead of using the adjacency matrix A for a GNN computation, we are going to use A plus A squared, right? If you, again, remember early on in the course, maybe lecture 2-3, we discussed that powering the adjacency matrix counts the number of nodes that are neighbors at level 2, level 3, and so on. So by basically powering the matrix and adding it to the adjacency matrix, now basically we connect all the nodes that are two hop neighbors. And this is very interesting, for example, especially in bipartite graphs, because if in a bipartite graph where, for example, authors and the papers they author, you create a squared, then basically you create a projection and you create either a paper co-authorship network or an author collaboration network, right? So this would mean that you either connect two authors that have written at least one paper together, or you connect two papers if they were written by the same author. It just depends. Do you do, you know, A times A transpose, or do you do A transpose times A in a case of a bipartite graph, because the adjacency matrix won't be square. So that's one idea how you can kind of include additional information. And what this will help in the graph neural network is that rather than, you know, if you think about message passing, an author sending a message to the paper and then paper sending it back to the author, by connecting two authors, they will be able to directly exchange messages, which means that the depth, the number of layers of the graph neural network will be able to be smaller, and you'll be able to train it faster. Of course, the issue will then become that you have too few, that you will have too many neighbors to aggregate from, and that may add more complexity. But we'll talk about how to fix that later. So if graphs are too sparse, as I said, one idea is to connect nodes to add these virtual edges between length 2 or length 3 connected nodes. Another idea is to add a virtual node. And the virtual node will then connect to, let's say, all or some carefully chosen subset of the nodes in the graph, right? So, for example, imagine you have a super sparse graph where two nodes are very far apart in the graph, right? They are, let's say, 10 hops apart, right? And now, if one node needs to send a message to the other node, you need a length, you need a 10-layer graph neural network to be able to allow for that communication. But in some cases, you may know that these two nodes actually need to communicate, even though they are farther apart in the original graph. They need to send messages to each other, right? One depends on the other. So what you can do in that case is you can create a virtual node and then connect, for example, several nodes to it. And this way, you can connect nodes that are very far in the original graph structure to be able to communicate with each other much more efficiently, right? So basically, after adding a virtual node, all the nodes will have a smaller distance to each other, so the message passing will be more efficient. It will happen faster. The depth of the graph neural network won't have to be that large. So that's another technique that sometimes is a good idea to have in your toolbox if the basic approaches don't work. And then, the last thing I want to talk about graph structure information is not when you have too few edges in the graph and you want to kind of make the message passing more efficient. The question becomes, what if you have too many edges? What if the graph is too large? Right, again, think of my Kim Kardashian example, right? Or Lady Gaga used to be the highest degree node in the Twitter network a few years ago, but I think she's not number one anymore. But the point is, right, you have this high degree nodes in networks and aggregating messages from millions or tens of millions or hundreds of millions of people that are connected to it can become quite expensive. So so far, right, we said let's use all the nodes, all the neighbors for message passing when defining the graph neural network. And the idea that we are going to explore here and introduce is, what if I sample nodes' neighborhood for message passing? And of course, I could do random sampling, but it turns out there are far better heuristics that allow you to really carefully select what neighbors to collect information from and what neighbors to ignore. So here is the idea. So the idea is that, for example, what if we randomly choose two neighbors to pass messages from in a given layer? So, for example, for neighbors of node A, we could decide that out of the three neighbors, we are only going to select two of them and ignore the third one. So this would, for example, in this case, mean that A only collects information from B and D, but ignores the C. So now our message passing computation graph would look like this. Why is this good? This is good because now computation graph is much smaller. Of course, why is it bad? Is because perhaps node C has very important information that would allow us to make a better prediction at node A, But because we ignored it, this will be it will be harder for the neural network to learn that pattern, right? So this is kind of the trade-off here is, yes, you gain computational efficiency, but in the worst case, you kind of lose some of the expressive power because you dropped out some edges, you dropped out some information that might be important. And of course, in practice, if you have a super high degree node, you can really subsample how many neighbors you aggregate information from, because you really want to kind of aggregate from important neighbors, and from all the kind of noisy unimportant ones, you can ignore them. That's kind of the intuition. So, and of course, we can do this sampling differently every time. We could even make it such that sampling changes between layers, and this way the network, the aggregation functions actually become robust to how many neighbors do you collect the information from, right? So the idea would be, for example, in the next layer or in the next epoch of training, we can sample different nodes for the same node A, right? So what this would mean is that, for example, now we resample and we decide to collect from C and D but ignore B. And this is now how the computation graph would look like. And this is also good because it adds robustness to our neural network training approach, right? It now means that A will be able to collect information, will learn how to robustly collect information from some subsets of its neighbors and won't suffer too much if, for example, an edge is missing in the network. So that's also one reason why this neighborhood sampling is a good approach. Why is this interesting is because in expectation, right, after a lot of different random samplings, we will get embeddings similar to the case when all nodes are being used. But the benefit is that this greatly reduces computational cost. And, you know, in these small graphs, this might not be so obvious, but if node A has 30 million neighbors, then we cannot aggregate from 30 million. The question is, can we decide what are the top 100, maybe top 1,000, most important nodes, most important, let's say, friends, if this is a social network, or the true friends of this person, and we want to aggregate information from them, rather than from all the kind of random followers all over the world, right? And by doing this subsampling, we can make the computation graphs much, much, much smaller, which allows us to scale GNNs to massive graphs. And this is very important in industrial applications like recommender systems in social networks, where you have, you know, networks of billions and tens of billions of nodes and edges, and you need this kind of techniques to be able to scale. And in practice, this is a very good approach to scale up graph neural networks. So this is what I wanted to say about neighborhood sampling and give you this example.